Hi, my name is Jonathan Roth, and this is This Week in Geopolitics. I'm joined by Jacob Shapiro, the Director of Analysis for Geopolitical Futures. Jacob, thank you for joining me.
Thanks for having me.
Jacob, I want to start out talking about what's happening with Russia and the United States. It seems like every single day there is a new revelation in terms of a hack that has happened, either the DNC emails or Hillary Clinton's, well, I guess we haven't actually gotten into Hillary Clinton's server yet, but Podesta's emails. We're getting into some very interesting territory here. And just last week, the U.S. officially said that Russia was the culprit in terms of revealing these emails through WikiLeaks. What's your take on who's actually been doing these hacks?
It's really impossible to know who's doing the hacks, and I'm not a cyber expert, so I couldn't tell you that for sure. Certainly, there are some indications that the hackers were based in Russia, but you would think that if these were Russian-backed hackers, that they would be able to cover their tracks better than these organizations that say they are Russian hackers did. When I look at this, I really look at it from the point of view of Putin doesn't really have a real reason to be messing around with the DNC's emails. And even if he does, these are very small potatoes issues when you look at the broader conflicts that are happening right now geopolitically between the United States and Russia. It's really a political sideshow, and I think it's really being played up in the United States for domestic political reasons.
Interesting. Okay. So following along those domestic political reasons and the narrative that's been built around these emails, let's just say, for instance, that we take this the logical step and say that Hillary Clinton, due to the polling that we're seeing now, becomes president. What does this mean for the U.S. relationship with Russia moving forward?
I don't think these emails mean particularly much. Hillary already has a tough stance on Russia. She has history going back and forth on Russia, and I think she wants to be tough on Russia. She wants to be very tough on Syria. She obviously doesn't want to see Russia expand itself in Ukraine. I think the geopolitical calculus with you is already set in there, and is set in on her being more antagonistic to Russia than is already being expected. The emails, if it's true and if she thinks that that's what happened, maybe it adds insult to injury, but I don't see that the emails by themselves create some situation that isn't already there.
All right, why don't we jump from there and talk about the U.S. relationship with Russia that seems to be moving in all kinds of different directions, in particular on the Syria issue right now. What is actually happening there? Because it seems like the U.S. almost broke off diplomatic relations with Russia over the bombing of Aleppo a couple of weeks ago, and yet they continue to talk. What's going on there?
Look, it's they're on again, they're off again. It's back and forth all over the place. The Russians, the newest thing now is that the Russians are sending an aircraft carrier and a carrier battle group from the north through the Straits of Gibraltar into the Mediterranean, and this is going to be the final battle for Aleppo. The fact of the matter is that the United States' first interest in Syria is preventing the Islamic State from growing. They are trying to hit the Islamic State. That is their main objective. Wiping out Assad's regime doesn't help them get to that objective. So obviously the United States doesn't like the Assad regime, but it's a secondary concern, and they're not willing to expend the resources necessary to tangle with Russia over Assad when they've got the battle for Mosul going on, and they've got the Islamic State. They finally have developed some momentum against them. So when you look at it from Russia's point of view, again, we've always said that Russia got involved in this conflict not because of any real affection or any real geopolitical advantage to the Assad regime. That's all about Ukraine. That's all about creating problems for the United States elsewhere that Russia can show that they can come in and help and then hopefully develop some leverage in the place where Russia cares the most, which is Ukraine.
Interesting. Okay, I did notice something, as it has been in the news here over the last couple of days, the Iraqi army has been invading Mosul and trying to take it back from ISIS. And what I had discovered through a little bit of investigating is that the city is surrounded on nearly all sides, except for one portion of the city that they're leaving open and essentially leaving a corridor and hoping that ISIS leaves and goes back to Syria, in which case I guess ISIS becomes more of Russia's problem. To what degree would there be cooperation between the Americans and the Russians on an issue like that?
There already is quiet cooperation between the Americans and the Russians on that. There are Russian planes flying in Syrian airspace. There are United States planes flying there. We already know that they are talking to a limited degree to make sure that they don't run into each other and so that they're deconflicting their various zones of operation. So obviously Russia has also been helping the Assad regime, and obviously there have been other misunderstandings on the ground. But when it comes to the Islamic State, there has been some cooperation already, and I think you'll see that continue. As for leaving a corridor open, though, for those who are left in Mosul for the Islamic State, the guys that are left in Mosul are going to fight till the end. I don't think they're going to be retreating on this one. Their defensive advantage is in the city. It doesn't make sense for them to leave now.
Interesting. Okay. And final question for you then. Because the temperature seems to be turned up so high right now due to the political situation in the U.S. and the election between Trump and Clinton, when the election is finally over, and say by the time we reach mid-November to late November into December, do you predict that we would see a lowering of the temperature with Russia moving forward, at least, you know, in terms of the rhetoric that we're seeing out there?
No, I don't. The geopolitical situation for both of them doesn't have tensions decreasing at all. If anything, I think that Russia is preparing to get more assertive, and the United States is going to stand against that. I would also say that I don't think Obama is going to take any forward aggressive movement at this point. I think he would probably have some level of dialogue and communication with the Clinton administration. If it's President Trump, which obviously seems like not a high degree of probability right now, but if it is, maybe that could change things, and maybe Obama will try and soften things or set things up in a particular way before he leaves office. But in general, no, I think Russia and the United States are on a path towards greater tension overall.
Subscribe for free to George Friedman's weekly column, This Week in Geopolitics, by clicking on the link in the description below. Each week, you'll receive for free George's in-depth analysis of the events and forces shaping our world. Again, click on the link below to subscribe to George Friedman's free weekly column, This Week in Geopolitics.